Welcome to the Nerd Party.
Hello and welcome to a special between takes episode of Missing Frames. Happy New Year. I'm Shawn Eastridge. Normally on Missing Frames, we watch all the movies we should have seen by this point in our lives. But on the Between Takes episodes, we like to do things off the beaten path. We do filmmaker interviews, franchise rewatches, and that means we've got the Franchyze Boyz back in the studio. There's Mr. Brad Gullickson over there. Welcome back, Brad.
Woo! B.O. and barbecue in the Zencaster room.
And we've got Aaron Prescott. Aaron, hello, good sir.
Just the Prince of Powder over here, baby.
And if you haven't guessed already by, you know, the title of the episode, we are going to be Franchyze Boyzing it up with the Predator series, which actually, as I think I mentioned to Brad before the show, could have just been a straight Missing Frames episode for me because I've only seen prior to this franchise watch the first movie. This is the first time I've seen any of the sequels.
Why is that, wow. Sean?
I think because I was scared. That's it. I'd not heard anything particularly glowing about any of the sequels, which
you haven't been talking to us then.
That's probably true. Cause I have to say, fairly or unfairly, nobody had really been going to bat for any of these. Like, you know, there isn't anything necessarily that's on the level of like a David Fincher Alien 3, I guess. Nobody has been like, oh, you've got to see Predators or Predator 2. I will get to my reviews. I don't want to spoil what my thoughts were on this, but I will say I was pleasantly surprised and also unpleasantly surprised by certain entries. But I, again, won't spoil. Let's talk a little bit about the Predator in general, how you were introduced to Predator, what you know about it. Brad, let's start with you. What is your earliest memory of this film franchise? How were you introduced to the Predator?
It's funny, usually when you ask that question, I'm like, I can't remember life before
you were ready
Star Wars.
After 2-3 years of doing these episodes, you finally figured out that you should do your homework and bring it to the table.
This time, I can come to the Franchyze Boyz and say, I remember the exact moment I watched the first Predator film. I was young. I was probably under 10. No, I was definitely under 10. I was visiting my grandfather, and my cousin Chris was also visiting my grandfather. And at the time, my grandfather and my aunt, they lived next door to each other, or sort of close to each other, the same neighborhood. And my aunt was out of town, and she had HBO. And ooh. Chris and I convinced my grandfather to go over to our aunt's house. And Chris wanted to watch whatever Mike Tyson fight was at the time. I cannot remember. What I remember about the Mike Tyson fight is we watched it. It lasted 30 seconds. Whoever Mike Tyson was fighting was done.
And there was no Predator. No Predator showed up in that boxing
match. Predator showed up in that fight. And then after the Tyson fight was a showing of the first Predator film. And I was already a huge Schwarzenegger fan. You know, Conan the Barbarian, Commando, that was my jam. I would have said at the time that Schwarzenegger was my favorite actor of all time. He's still one of my faves. And I was dying to see Predator. And I was so excited to watch this film after the Tyson fight. And it was when I was just starting to dabble with R-rated movies. And Predator, I thought I could handle. But that moment when they pull back the trees and there's like all those dangling skin corpses, I remember going like, ooh, I'm too young. I'm too young. Oh. And hiding my eyes. But I got over that fear. We watched the rest of Predator, and I've been in love with the franchise ever since.
Can I ask you, was this, and you know, unfortunately we do have to kind of put the franchises together or mention them in the same breath, but was this pre-Alien for you? Did you see this before the Alien movies?
I believe I did. I'm not 100% sure. If I had seen an Alien film before Predator, it would have been Aliens.
Okay.
I think we talked about this in our Alien Franchyze Boyz episode, but I saw the sequel before I ever saw the Ridley Scott movie.
Same with me. And Aaron, did you go to the Predator route first or Alien route first? And again, just like Brad, how did you discover Predator?
I'm sure it was Ted Turner's fault that I watched it.
As many things are.
As young as I did. So I don't really remember. I truly don't remember when and where. I just remember of my youth, Predator was kind of there. And, you know, I think I'm, you know, hand in hand with Brad. We're in the holding hands club. Yeah. With when it comes to Schwarzenegger. He was just like the coolest. He was the best. He was the last action hero. Like, you know, how much cooler could a guy get? Like the biggest muscles and, you know, just smoking those big cigars and
biggest muscles and the biggest heart.
Right. That's the biggest muscle of them all. And you know, he was part of the remember the presidential physical fitness test?
Yes.
Yeah, and he was promoting that stuff. Man, he felt like he was a part of you. So, you know, when you get to watch the Predator in like a much sanitized version on TV, that's where I got my thing. I'm pretty sure I saw Alien before Predator, but there was something so cool about Predator because, you know, when you're watching Alien, a lot of it's taking place in you know, the darkness of night and inside spaceships and deep space. Predator, you're like, oh, bright green jungle. And you got this faintly sort of, you know, invisible thing with dreadlocks. Like, how this couldn't possibly be any cooler. So there was that. And I always kind of, you know, for me, Predator and Predator 2. Predator 2 was not a dirty word growing up, and I think it is for a lot of people. But I always kind of saw them one in the same, and to this day still do.
I have a Predator 2 story also, but I was going to save that for Predator 2 because I agree with Aaron that Predator 2 not a dirty word or no. Two words.
I can't count.
I was introduced to Predator through the Aliens versus Predator craze because that's
oh,
when
boy.
I, you know, I was a 90s kid growing up. I guess that was what 90. It was sparked by Predator 2, I'm pretty sure. So,
early well, the 90s. Alien versus Predator comic, I believe, came after Predator 2, but there was a Dark Horse comic that predated Predator 2, and a lot of Predator 2's elements comes from that concrete jungle Dark Horse comic.
Gotcha. So
it predated Predator.
I knew about Predator specifically through the Aliens versus Predator stuff and didn't really, you know, I knew the creature. I knew the design. I admired the design. I thought it was awesome. But I was, you know, at that age, I was not watching R-rated movies. I really wasn't until my late teens and then going into college, it occurred to me, and this is, you know, Aliens came first for me. I saw literally Aliens first, and then I saw the first Alien. And really, I think I saw Alien 3 and Resurrection before I saw a single Predator movie. And it wasn't until I was going to film school that I had it readily available. It was at my school's library, and I was like, I should probably watch that. And one of the things I remember, not at that point, but earlier as I was connecting the dots regarding the Predator franchise, is realizing that Schwarzenegger was involved. I didn't know that because I was introduced to Predator through Alien. So I didn't realize that it was like, oh, wait, this is an 80s action movie starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. I thought this was like a science fiction, like something more along the lines of Alien. And that was really my reaction watching it for the first time was, you know, years later after I discovered Schwarzenegger was in the movie, actually watching it and the mesh of genres that it was kind of threw me for a loop because I was expecting something maybe a little bit more creepy and horrifying and gothic like Alien. And what I got was balls to the walls, 80s action movie. Also, there's a science fiction monster in this.
Yeah.
So it was kind of like, wait a second, what? It wasn't as sophisticated as Alien, but I still, it threw me for a loop at first. And I was like, I don't know how I feel about this. But by the end, I was like, okay, no, I'm on board with it. And I think watching it for Franchyze Boyz, this is the first time I've seen the first Predator in a long time. And I wonder, I mean, I think you guys seem more familiar with this franchise in general and this film. Aaron, how does Predator hold up for you on this rewatch?
Predator holds up excessively well, as in like it feels like the if you were to like draw up a vision board and it just like the title just said 80s action cinema, I feel like every single bit of this would just you'd eventually just be like, oh, we just made Predator. You have big bulging oily muscles, you have, you know, Marines and commandos, like literally with the biggest guns you've ever seen,
yes,
mowing down bodies blowing up and splitting up everywhere. Cool
lots
visual
of,
effects.
Lots
of blood squibs. Cool visual effects. Cool special effects. Aliens. Like Alan Silvestri's score.
Yeah.
Like you can't get any more 80s than this movie. This is the definition. You look up 80s action movie in the dictionary, it just says Predator. That's
it. Predator. Yeah. Brad, what about you?
Oh, gosh, I think this is a masterpiece. As a Schwarzenegger aficionado, I think it's his best work. And
wow, but more than Terminator.
Yes. Okay. I will take Predator over Terminator, Terminator 2, Total Recall, Commando, wow. Raw Deal. It's not as good as Raw Deal, guys.
That's true.
Over Jingle All the Way?
Definitely better than Jingle All the Way. Better than The Villain.
Better
Conan
than Batman
the Destroyer.
And Robin.
You know, this is, I think, is an important aspect to the Predator story. And I think it's something that I share with Aaron, but I possibly don't share with Sean. Sean, what was your relationship with Arnold Schwarzenegger growing up? Did you have one at all? Have you seen Raw Deal?
Arnold and I, we go way back. We're besties. No, I knew Arnold. You know, I'd seen things like, you know, when I was younger, my mom was a huge Kindergarten Cop fan. So I think I was kind of slowly introduced to Arnold through the comedies because that was all I could handle at that age. But I saw Terminator 2 pretty young. Like I was 10 or 11 and I loved it. So I was pretty familiar with Schwarzenegger, but not so much in like 80s action mode. So I hadn't seen him in Commando or Predator, like really kind of, you know, I know Terminator, the first Terminator was before that, but really like him as the leading man, like the action hero, I hadn't seen that. And I think maybe I'd caught bits and pieces of Last Action Hero. So going into this, it was interesting almost to see him play like just a dude, you know, like, it, you know, he's not
as
like
much
he's
as just a dude as he can be.
I think, well, exactly. You know, he's not just a dude. He is the dude.
Yes.
You know what I mean? But like, in a way, he is playing the straight man in this cast. And I was used to him being like the murderous robot or the cop trying to be a kindergarten teacher. You know, something like where he's playing against type. So this was like, oh, he's just... I say just as if it's reductive, and there's nothing just or reductive about who he is.
I don't think he's playing against type in Predator. Like I would say that this is like the ultimate Schwarzenegger performance.
Exactly,
in a lot of ways.
Exactly.
You know, for me, Schwarzenegger was the first cinematic Pokemon. I had to collect them all. And, you know, that was quite the feat as a kid, as you were hunting through video stores to like check out a movie like Raw Deal. And I remember when I finally got to see Raw Deal, how excited I was and how lukewarm I was to it once I consumed it. But I still watch Raw Deal with a warm sensation, but not as warm a sensation as I do when I watch Predator. And Predator is great because it is a fantastic vehicle for Arnold Schwarzenegger, but it's also this movie that is wall-to-wall strapped with sexual Tyrannosauruses like Jesse Ventura,
yes.
Bill Duke,
yes.
Carl Weathers.
Yes.
You know, the cast is as much of its delight as the monster, as Schwarzenegger mm-hmm. himself, as the action. And that's what all the sequels try to replicate, is this eclectic cadre of cool weirdos. But rarely do the sequels match the energy of the first Predator.
Oh, totally. Yeah. And this is really, I mean, this is the film that launched 1,000 GIFs. Like, I don't know if people realize how much that they quote or how many GIFs that they use are actually from this film.
Yeah.
I remember watching Predator for the first time, and when Schwarzenegger yells, "Get to the chopper!" I was like, "That's this movie? I had no idea!" Like, it was just amazing. And of course, you know, like...
It's the Casablanca of 80s action films.
Yes! Yeah. You know, it, Dylan! And the hand slap, like, it was all that just kind of, like, my mind was just being blown. All these fireworks were going off in my head, just like the sheer overwhelming amount of this stuff on top of the 80s machismo and all that stuff. But it, like, I think it threw me for a loop the first time I watched it, because really Predator, the Predator creature itself, is the cherry on top of this product. But like, I was not expecting it to be such an 80s action movie. Like, the Predator is almost like, oh, and also there's a monster in this movie. Like, it almost threw me off a little bit when the movie shifts gears and is like, now this creature, this futuristic creature, is going to stalk these guys and take them out one by one. Do you see that dissonance, or is it something that's so ingrained in your childhoods that you don't see the split between 80s action movie and also science fiction creatures film? Does it mesh kind of seamlessly for you guys?
I think it's hard for me to separate the two, because when this movie was coming out and you would go to like video library, there would be the cutout standee of Schwarzenegger, but he was in that infrared imaging. So you knew going into it that there was an alien presence in this film. And while the thing is, the movie opens up with the ship coming to Earth.
It's true. It's
very much like The Thing from Another World. This is a science fiction movie, and it's saying that at the beginning. And then you kind of forget it as we get the special forces team going down to South America and just obliterating that village. And the obliteration of that village is like astonishing in just like how grotesque the apocalypse is.
It's also great because the movie, you know, we've had some absurdist, like the handshake, like, you know, this is going to be kind of kooky and fun, but when Schwarzenegger kills the guy what does he do? He like pins him to the wall and
stick around.
I like, imagine that's the last thing you see when you die. Just like,
you're like, sometimes wait. I do, Sean. Sometimes I do.
I love it so much, but it is like, it just is completely taking no prisoners. We are going to like be full of perfect punchlines and just absurd amounts of explosions. Like, you really get the sense that they're going all out.
But you do get all these POV shots of the unseen predator. So you do see all these weird infrared shots, and you're like, okay, so something is watching, and whatever that something is, it's not human. And I like how slow
it
takes to really reveal.
Or, if slow is the right word to describe this movie.
Yeah.
But I think you're right on you know, when talking about it from a science fiction point of view, because up until that point, we're getting Commando 2.0. You know,
yes, exactly.
It's everything that we've come to know and love from Arnold has been that sort of over the top crazy action. And the one thing that they really had to get right was the creature design. And making it that iconic, especially when knowing they're going to be doing it in broad daylight and having something that, funny enough, that will be seen, even though for, you know, a lot of this, you know, the shots, we have that, you know, sort of weirdo, semi-translucent sort of look to it. They have to have a really cool looking silhouette, and they nailed it. Not on the first try. But you know, it's amazing, that Stan Winston and them were able to, you know, pull that, out of nowhere and, you know, finally get something that was going to be as iconic, as it eventually was.
Sean, have you seen the images of the Predator alien as worn by Jean-Claude Van Damme? It's embarrassing.
Yeah.
I do recall Jean-Claude Van Damme, being originally cast as the Predator. I mean, good for him. Kudos to him for saying, you know what? No, like, it just, it doesn't make sense to me. Somebody like that, who is basically kind of having a parallel path to Schwarzenegger's, not quite as successful, but who was in his own right going to be that kind of action star. You really need somebody who is imposing and tall and actually, like, physicality wise is going to move like that creature versus like wanting to make the movie more about themselves.
Yeah, there is one part about it being where he just is such an imposing and towering figure. But Kevin Peter Hall puts a lot of, you know, just a little like fine tuning of, you know, the way he moves, just creates such a much more menacing presence than just being a big dude in a costume. Cause yeah, I don't know if I could see a tiny little, JCVD just parkouring his way through the jungle.
I love him. Yeah. I love Jean-Claude Van Damme, I think you need an egoless performer in that suit because
you need
a great suit.
You need a great suit. That's step one. So like once you get rid of Jean-Claude Van Damme and that weird bug-like thing that he was wearing and you get Kevin Peter Hall and Stan Winston's creation, like that's the shark in Jaws moment. Like Predator operates a lot like Spielberg's movie where, you know, it's all under the surface. It's all in the jungle. It's all invisible to you until it's not. And when it's not, it is such a satisfying reveal. You know, you got the helmet and then the helmet comes off and then you got the mandibles and he is one ugly mother effer and he is, you know, beautiful.
I think the Predator really, like, I love the way you described it, Aaron, as Commando 2.0. And the Predator basically hijacks this movie. And the way the characters react to the Predator is essentially like this movie is what happens if the Predator invaded an 80s action movie. Yeah. That is basically the premise of the film because these guys are acting like superstars. Like they blow up everything at that village and then they literally shoot the forest for how long is that sequence? 20 minutes when they first encounter the Predator, where literally everyone is like, yeah, I'm into it. And they all have their guns and they're all firing and it's amazing. And you know, one by one, the Predator takes them out until it's mano a mano Arnold versus Predator. But it basically, it does feel like that to me. And that's not a bad thing. It feels like the Predator is what helps elevate the film. But it does feel like the Predator comes in and is like, no, this, you don't understand. I'm the star of this movie. And then basically Schwarzenegger has to fight him for that role.
I think director John McTiernan was kind of making a parody as well. You know, that scene where all the guys are blasting their machine guns into the forest and hitting nothing. And they literally say like, we got nothing. I believe McTiernan has said like that's the point is that these guys are impotent. Their machismo, everything that they value in the face of the Predator is meaningless. And the Predator comes into the 80s action movie to say this genre you love is a joke.
Yes.
and I really revel in that.
I mean, there is a knowing, winking sense. And John McTiernan would get a little bit more room to wink at the audience with Die Hard. I think he, you know, it's amazing that Die Hard came out the following year. I don't know what his schedule looked like, but God bless him for doing it. But things like, you know, when Jesse Ventura's like, ain't got time to bleed, and then the other guy reacts, he just goes, okay, like it's so funny. Like the line itself is great, but it really hinges on the second guy responding and just being like, okay, like he's
Richard Chavez
watching.
Is Pancho.
Yes,
he doesn't get enough love.
He doesn't because the line is so like, you know, ain't got time to bleed is a fantastic line, but his reaction to that line is really what sells it for me, and is really, I think, McTiernan saying like, "Yep, it's that kind of movie. You're gonna have to roll with it."
For me, it was always Bill Duke dry shaving and just looking straight into the forest and just that blank stare. And like, he sees it sees him back. Like it's beautiful. Maybe it was just the dry shaving that got me. And I was just like that.
And he breaks the blade,
off on the cheek. Oh yes. Goodness.
Yes. That goodness. Is great.
Put that on the vision board. Goodness.
And you know, once the kills like start piling up, we have no shortage of creativity. I think my favorite is probably, there's so many to choose from, but the Carl Weathers arm and I, you know, used to perfection in Arrested Development. Which was actually the first time I think I saw that clip was when I saw Arrested Development. But I just love the him screaming, the arm is still firing the gun. Do you guys have, well, Brad, we'll start with you. Do you have any particular favorite kills in this movie?
Well, I think Carl Weathers is probably it, but I also really like Bill Duke when he gets the blast through the skull.
Yes.
As far as violence is concerned, it's very memorable the first time you watch that because those brains are just so chunky and they splatter right on the camera lens.
And then in the wide shot, his head is mysteriously intact. It's like, wait a second, didn't your head explode? Maybe not.
But yeah, that would be my number two, Bill Duke.
Okay. All right. Aaron, what about you?
I mean, there's so many great kills, but I want to just kind of jump ahead to, I feel like why all the, you know, we see all these amazing kills and we know that this creature is powerful and he can just like mow down all these, you know, there's the biggest, strongest, toughest guys we've ever seen, but there's a sense of intelligence in the way that, we can understand how, you know, when Arnold is the last man standing, how he can take him out when, you know, he figures out he's seeing an infrared and he gets covered in this mud. There's such a cool, like, intelligence to that instead of just, you know, taking a guy with a gun and a alien with a gun and just, you know, having them go after each other. I love, you know, he starts going all Kevin McAllister on, on the alien and it works. You know, it's something that is, you know, I think the best of those 80s action movies will kind of fail at just trying to be bigger and louder and making more commotion. And this one, you know, kind of slows things down and, you know, it tries something from a different approach.
It basically strips him of his 80s action movie that he made.
Completely. Yeah. With, yeah.
Right. And
he knows he can't win.
Yeah.
You know, as big as his muscles are, he can't do it.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's what makes the movie so brilliant is that to me, what elevates the film. And again, all this stuff is fun. It's exciting. It's ridiculous. It's hysterical. But like at a certain point, I think what makes this movie, what elevates the film is the final like 20 or 30 minutes when it's just Schwarzenegger versus the Predator, where you get the sense of like, oh, McTiernan really understood what he was doing with this story. Really, like these guys can't beat this thing. They used all their explosions, all their weapons. Every last one of them has been taken out. And like you're saying, Aaron, now you have to think strategically. Now it's you versus him. And it's you throw the guns away and you have to take this thing on. And suddenly the movie becomes, for me at least, it becomes more thrilling because it's not so much about like, oh, it's 80s action movie. It's a survival, like you were going to fight this thing and just barely scrape by using the tools you have at your disposal in this jungle and using whatever intellect and intelligence you have against this creature. And that's where, for me, it goes from being really fun, wacky 80s movie to like, oh, this is just a great action movie and genuinely thrilling.
Yeah, I think if you want to know like how good Predator is, you just watch the same Arnold Schwarzenegger movie or the other Arnold Schwarzenegger movie that came out in 1987, The Running Man, which is a film that I cherish. I think is so much fun. But when compared to Predator, you really start to understand how unique and how impressive Predator is as just a standalone movie. We haven't mentioned that the Predator voice or the gargling of the Predator are done by Peter Cullen, Optimus Prime. So also extremely well done.
I also want to point out, and I'm glad you brought that out, and I love his like Vincent Price-esque laughter at the end when he's about to explode.
As he's like mimicking Sonny, right?
Yes. Yes. And this movie, hands down, can this go on the short list of greatest end credits sequences ever?
Oh, 100%.
Yes, yeah. Because for those who don't know, this film ends with basically a sitcom end credits where everyone turns and poses and looks at the camera, except for Arnold. I feel like they were like, just take a shot from the film. Like he couldn't do the jokey sitcom look. They had to use footage that they'd actually shot for the film. he couldn't do it.
But yeah, it's wonderful. And like, I think the only other director who does that consistently is John Landis. Every John Landis movie ends the same way, with the exception of a few. Like, it doesn't happen in American Werewolf in London, but like,
no,
Blues Brothers, Spies Like Us, flicks like that.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's, I mean, it's great. I love that ending so much, and it always lifts my spirits. But all right, that's the first Predator. We did it. I guess the only ratings we really can do for this is how many choppers you would get to on behalf of Predator. So, Brad, we'll start with you. How many choppers do you give Predator?
You know, Predator to me is like Star Wars. It's five choppers. It's a masterpiece.
Aaron, how about you?
I do know it has, you know, small faults, so I'm just going to give it a 4.5 out of 5 choppers.
Okay, I'll knock it down another half and give it a solid 4, but I do think it's an absolute action classic, and it's a blast. I think the reason I knock it down is because it's really unfair, honestly, but I don't think it's as sophisticated as even Die Hard or
Alien.
Sophisticated.
Oh,
yeah.
Sophisticated.
All right. Speaking of sophisticated, let's move on to Predator 2. This is my first time watching Predator 2. Aaron,
what a treat.
You said you saw these basically like they were hand in hand for you.
Oh, yeah.
So there was no disconnect. You didn't feel any of the like confusion or like what's going on, why did they do this, why is this in 1997? You're just like, this is the way it goes, that's the way Predator 2 rolls.
I mean, the only thing that confused me is I was like, when are we, why do why do Danny Glover's pants look so itchy, like why is like what's going on, you know, are we in the future, are we in the past, are we in a different reality?
The like, Predator comes to Earth every 10 years. 1987, 1997.
Okay. I was an idiot kid. I didn't care about that. I didn't know what was going on. I wanted to see the Predator just get down and boogie, and doing it in downtown LA as if some, you know, as Reaganomics has just like ravaged the world. It was beautiful. I couldn't get over it.
Brad, what about you?
I was greatly anticipating the release of Predator 2. So I was 10 years old. I had seen Predator at my grandfather's house, and we had moved to Virginia, and I had discovered comic books, and I had discovered Dark Horse Comics and their Predator licensed books, and I was in love with all of them. And they had an adaptation of Predator 2 available, and I desperately wanted it, but the first issue was rated 18 plus because it had some boobies in it. And I remember went to my father and I was like, the guy at the comic book shop, Joe Gumbinger at Burke Used Books and Comics in Virginia, he won't sell me this comic book because he says it's smut and I'm not age appropriate for smut. And my dad's like, well, let me go look. And so I brought my dad to the shop. He opened up the book. He's like, it's just like a couple pairs of boobs. Sell the comic to my son. I bought the comic, read the comic. Super excited. I remember being at Pentagon City Mall, walking up to the movie theater, seeing the first poster for Predator 2. And the way that Pentagon City Mall theater worked is there was a series of steps that went down from the food court. So I'm on the food court level. I see the poster for Predator 2. I freak out. I jump the steps and I collapse on the floor of the theater in front of the concession stands. And I look up and there's a real cute girl staring down at me. And I have humiliated myself before the Predator 2 poster, but it was worth it. So I was pretty excited.
You've done nothing
Sean.
But stare down at you that the rest
was,
of your life.
That was the most detailed first watch I think we've ever gotten.
And that, I hadn't even watched it yet.
Write a script.
And you hadn't watched it. Yeah.
That was me just getting excited to watch it. My parents would not take me to see the theater to watch it. I had to wait for it to be on VHS. We rented it from Errol's Video. I watched it with my mom. My cousin Chris was again there with us. And the three of us watched Predator 2.
Wait, so you had injured yourself so severely that you didn't see it that day?
No, my parents wouldn't let me see it. That was me just getting excited about the poster that I saw from the food court, Sean. Okay.
I thought you were saying, oh, I knocked myself out and I came to and the pretty girl was standing there.
No, no.
I wouldn't have been remotely surprised if you were like, and I woke up and there was a beautiful girl there and that's how I met Lisa, and Predator 2 basically was our matchmaker. Like,
yes.
That would have not surprised me. You could have gone that route.
But I didn't.
Well, again, this is the first time I've ever seen Predator 2, but its reputation precedes it. Like, I've heard a lot of... This is part of the reason I never really watched the Predator sequels. Like, I was just very nervous about, oh, am I going to just feel disappointed? It doesn't live up to the first one. So I've just flat out avoided them up to this point in my life. And I have to say, Predator 2 is not as terrible as everyone makes it out to be.
Put that on the poster.
I'll take it.
Yeah, I don't love it. I don't think it's as good as the first movie, but how many movies are as good as the first Predator? So I appreciate how they're trying to do something absurdly different. It feels like a weird, like, I almost wish Paul Verhoeven had made Predator 2.
Yes.
It feels like it should have been made by him.
Mm-hmm.
But I let you know, Danny Glover is great in it. I love that we get Bill Paxton in it, which is fantastic.
Full Paxton. He's going full Paxton on this.
He really is. And honestly, as strange as the decision to make it a quasi-futuristic Los Angeles is, I kind of liked how wacky that idea is in general. So I am not going to go out on a limb and say, like, oh my God, Predator 2 is, you know, a masterful sequel, but I certainly don't hate it, I think, as much as many people do. I kind of do empathize, though. Like, I think there's a weakness to bringing the Predator into an urban environment. Like, I think the Predator really works better when it's like, you're out in the middle of nowhere and this thing is stalking you, and putting him in a city. Like, I do see why people were maybe thrown off by this. But I don't know. I don't mind that. Brad, like, is there something unique about that makes it work for you?
I mean, I love Predator 2, but I also agree that I'm not going to be like, well, guess what, everyone? This is the Godfather 2 of the Predator franchise.
I'm just making sure. There have been some instances on this show.
I know. I'm not going to say Predator 2 is a masterpiece, but I think Predator 2 is a wild swing. And as a wild swing, it's so much fun to watch. It is very weird. The decision to set it in a quasi-futuristic Los Angeles that's caught in the mix with this gang war between the Jamaicans and the Colombians is very strange. But what the movie does right is, again, like the first Predator, it concentrates on hiring actors to play really interesting weirdos.
Yes.
And this movie is weirdo, 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 weirdo populated. And Danny Glover, I'm so glad you highlighted Danny Glover as Mike Harrigan, because I think it's one of my favorite Danny Glover performances, because you've never seen anything like this from him. He is so unhinged. That scene where he accosts Gary Busey in the hallway at the stairs and he throws him up against the wall. Danny Glover is acting to the heavens and beyond.
I mean, he's essentially playing Martin Riggs from Lethal Weapon.
But on crack.
Yeah, I agree. Well, yes.
We're actually on Nuke.
Which that is Martin Riggs.
Yes, yeah. He is giving it his all. I also read that apparently he really loves this movie, his performance in the movie.
Like, as he should.
In high regard. It's something that's well worth, like, he brought his A game. Like, again, like you said, Brad, nobody is slouching, nobody is slacking off. And Danny Glover in particular is bringing that Oscar-worthy A game to this movie, and he's very clearly having fun with it.
Yeah.
It's a strange movie, though. Like,
yes.
I can't quite wrap my head around some of the choices, but it, design-wise, it is very cool. Like, the production design is cool. Like, the gang leader, his condo, whatever
King Willie.
It is.
King Willie, the Prince of Powder.
Yeah. King Willie, like, the Prince of Powder, played by Calvin Lockhart, doing a crazy accent, but succeeding with that crazy
accent.
Wait, just
to let you know, internet, if you can go out and find it, there are instances of Brad Gullickson doing said accent.
No. Incorrect.
I'm sure we can blackmail him in some way. If, like, we can find those, download those, and hold him for ransom, that'd be perfect.
Sean, Sean, he can't see the eyes of the demon until then become a Colin. And if you can't see the eyes of the demon, you shouldn't look up any of that In the Mouth of Darkness podcast demon stuff.
I also, in general, Predator 2, as weird and wacky as it is, I think if there's another week, okay, so yes, it's not the first Predator, so I know that's why a lot of people are immediately like, this movie sucks. But honestly, plot-wise, I think what holds it back maybe is the fact that it is kind of repeating the same beats of the first Predator. It's not ready to commit fully to this brand new wacky idea. It's basically like, okay, now we're going to reintroduce the Predator again. We're going to, you know, it's only saving grace, I think, is that we see the Predator a little bit earlier, but it
basically is. And we have
so
many new gadgets.
Yes, mm-hmm. We have lots of gadgets, which I think helps keep it fresh. But in general, story-wise, it's still like a bunch of people saying, what is this thing? What's going on? And I think because we're following that same trajectory, it does, like, from a story standpoint, keep it from feeling as unhinged as I think it should have been. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it totally does. I think if you watch Predator 2 next to Predator, you're doing it no favors. But if you suddenly just pop on Predator 2 one night and watch it apart from the franchise, I think that is a fantastic way to spend an evening.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Man, it has lots of cool stuff in it. Like, you know, again, the final scenes where Danny Glover is on the spaceship and you'd get that infamous tease of the xenomorph skull. But like, it's a really creepy design. It's very effective. I love him yelling at the guys. Like, again, his unhinged performance, just like screaming at them the same way Arnold is kind of like expecting for them to, you know, wreck his day. It's the same ending, but it's still like, we're getting a little bit more insight into what the Predator's background is. What does the inside of their spaceship look like? We're getting a little bit more information, but I almost wish like Danny Glover had ended up on that spaceship halfway through the movie. And then the rest of the movie is him maybe like trying to like, he's learning more, he's exploring, but also trying to survive. I don't know if I needed this to end, like to stay on Earth. I know budget-wise it doesn't
make
sense.
But I like what I like about it is is that weird future world. And I like all the detectives, and I like the Morton Downey Jr. hardcore / hard copy journalist. There's a lot of flavor in this movie that's just odd but compelling. And because of that, you know, all the drippings on this movie, It doesn't make me that upset that it does follow the formula of the first one almost to the letter, because you've got Gary Busey doing Gary Busey.
Yes.
For sure. Yeah. I think that's my issue or non-issue with the Predator franchise as a whole is I just kind of dig the premise of us being hunted, you know, we're the greatest game. And it you know, I think we'll talk about this later in especially another one of the sequels, but there, the idea of just, you know, kind of plopping the Predator down in this situation or that situation and just kind of rehashing out all this, you know, who is this? What is this thing? How can we track it down? And, you know, now it's starting to unfold tiny little pieces. I like that we ended up in the spaceship at the very end. You know, it kind of felt like, you know, a kind of a modern day twist. I mean, this thing is now, you know, what, 30 years old. But this felt like one of those kind of like end credit sequences that you'd stay around after a Marvel movie or something. And then all of a sudden you're like, holy shit. There's an alien skull and you know, and you're like, just, I love the little, you know, teases that it's putting into something that's probably, well, at least at that point would amount to nothing, but there's something fun and exciting about that sort of thing. Brad, go for it.
I just think that we shouldn't underappreciate the escalation of the final fight and where it begins with the CIA G-men characters in the slaughterhouse. Like the slaughterhouse sequence, I mean, there's nothing like the slaughterhouse sequence in any of the other Predator films.
No, it's great. It's great.
And it it goes from there to the apartment buildings, then all the way down into the sewers where the spaceship is. And then you get a one-on-one combat fight between the Predator and Danny Glover. And Danny Glover does what Arnold can't. He kills him with his hands.
Yeah.
You know, with a razor disc as well.
Well, that's why, you know, watching it, you know, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I get that the setting is weird. I get that it's wackier and it feels different from the first Predator movie. But to your point, once they get into that slaughterhouse, that whole scene, I'm like, this is pretty badass. Like, this is, there's some really good kills here. We got some cool gadgets. And all the way through the rest of the film, again, like the first Predator, those final 30 minutes or so are pretty fantastic. And at that point I was like, wait a second, I think I'm enjoying, like, I don't hate Predator 2. I don't even dislike it. This is actually like pretty cool. And we're getting some unique Predator stuff that we didn't see in the first movie, but that would become so synonymous with this character. And I think that's why I was like, hold on, this really is not as bad as everyone has made it out to be. Not in the way I expected, at least.
And it will only get better on rewatch, Sean. Uh-huh.
For sure. So, Brad, how many alien skulls would you give Predator 2?
So this is the movie where I lose my mind a little bit, okay? Like, I'm not going to say it's better than the first Predator, but I am going to say it's goddamn great. And I'm going to give it 4, whatever we're giving it 4 out of. 4.
Okay, great. Alien skulls, Danny Glovers, whatever. Yeah. Aaron, how about you?
There you go.
Yes, 3.5 whatevers is what I'm giving.
Okay, I'll give it a solid 3 down the middle. This is good. So this is like the first time in a while I think we've all had varying rankings or ratings for the film. So let's move on to the, what is it? When was this? 2007, 2009?
No, it's pretty late. Predators. It's 2010.
Wow. So we're talking 20 years after Predator 2. And, well, to be fair, you know, Brad, do you want to, you know, you were kind enough to, you totally didn't rewatch the Alien vs. Predator movies, and it's okay, I forgive you. But Brad did want to put out there that he loves those movies.
I do, and as does apparently Shane Black. We're going to get to the Predator, but the Predator proves that they're in continuity with the rest of this franchise, just FYI.
So we had, it hadn't been quite 20 years since we'd seen the Predator, but it had been 20 years since we got a genuine Predator film, just without any crossovers, without any franchising, just Predators. How did we feel? Did you guys, I assume you guys saw this in the theater. Aaron, did you see this in the theater when it came out?
Yes. And I feel like I have not seen it since that time, and I remember thinking it was a fine Predator movie then, and I think it's a fine Predator movie now.
Brad, you even hit the raise hand button because very clearly
that was an accident.
Okay, but I'm hoping for, does this theater going experience compare remotely to the not seeing Predator 2, but just being at the theater?
I remember to see Predator 2. Being very excited to watch Predators. I remember the build up to Predators. I even went to watch Nimrod Antel's previous film Armored in the theater when I heard he was announced to be the director of Predators. And after I saw Armored, I was less excited about Predators. And when I watched it initially in the theater, I thought it was okay, or to use Aaron's word, fine. And I had not really seen it since I had picked up the Blu-ray, because at the time I was buying every Blu-ray. I gotta say, rewatching Predators, I liked it a lot more than I remembered. I had a good time with this rewatch.
Oh, good. Good. Yeah, first time seeing Predators. I remember it. I do remember specifically when it came out, though, because there was just this vibe, not only because of the title, which was very clearly referencing Aliens, like, no, this is the real sequel. Again, another indication that we're knocking Predator 2 down a peg, another indication that we're trying to erase it from the continuity. There was just this feeling of like, no, this is the real Predator sequel. It's got like an all-star cast. You have Adrian Brody, you have Mahershala Ali in this movie. Like, it's just a crazy, amazing cast. And I just, you know, I wasn't really that interested in seeing it, but I was like, oh, Robert Rodriguez, his name's attached, that's pretty cool. So there was just this feeling of like, oh, if you're going to attach all this talent and all this excitement and hoopla and make a big deal about it being the real sequel to Predator, it's probably going to be pretty great. And I remember the reviews were pretty lukewarm. Watching it, I think on paper, this is a great idea and execution. I enjoy it. I don't dislike it, but it didn't bowl me over. I think, the characters just aren't as interesting as that one. You know, interesting is not the right word for the first Predator movie or even the second Predator movie. Maybe just as like colorful as the previous films. And there's a portion of the film in the middle where they meet Lawrence Fishburne that the movie just kind of drags to a dead stop. But it's not bad. I don't know. There's not enough flair to it to make me super thrilled about the movie. Though, is that aligning with you guys, or how do you feel, Aaron? Does this hold up better on a rewatch, like with Brad, or do you feel kind of the same way?
It was just as fine as it was before. I mean, the cast of characters, they're good, but they don't hold the same bigger than life persona that Predator had, or even Predator 2. I would say like both those like ensemble casts just had a lot of, you know, gravitas, even though this one's got like, you know, Walton Goggins, you know, lighting up the screen
with my favorite line in the movie, which is just "your ass is awesome."
Yeah. And there's so many different like little like characterizations that they're trying to go for, but they're all just really just trying to be a badass and yeah. Without even really saying much other than that one line, there was nothing really that held on to anything feeling like, you know, a classic Predator feel, other than putting us into a different type of situation. You know, obviously they find out that they are now on either on the Predator planet or another planet.
Not a Predator planet. It's an alien planet.
All right, chill out. All right, yeah. Where are we?
It's an alien. It's a game reserve for the Predators.
I didn't know if it was an actual reserve on the Predator planet.
No, we've seen the Predator planets in the Aliens versus Predator movies and in the comics.
Listen, we're not talking about Alien versus Predator here, okay?
Brad is the Alien versus Predator.
I know he is,
expert.
And we have to take him down a peg because this is not going to happen here again.
This is the only place where he gets to flex that muscle, so just let him have it.
It's a puny muscle.
So, yeah, there's a feel to this, like, it's almost what you would expect the comic book version of Predator to be. Like, again,
saying the comic book. Gross, Sean.
Listen. Here's the reason I say that. A guy with a katana fighting a Predator. On paper, visually, that works for me. Seeing it in the film, I'm like, oh, that wasn't quite as awesome as I expected it to be.
Yeah, but you're using comic book as a pejorative in that sense.
Yeah, it was. It really was.
I'm trying not to use it in a negative. I'm trying to say this movie has a lot of like good ideas on paper that I see visually. Like comic books, I'm thinking visual, exciting, almost a little outlandish, but more for the like awesomeness factor. You know what I mean? Like a guy with a katana fighting a Predator is a very comic book. Like to me, that's an image I see in a Predator comic book. And it's like, okay, this is going to be really awesome in a movie. And then it's kind of just like, okay. And I feel like this movie is full of those ideas where it's like, in theory, this is cool, but execution, it doesn't quite work. But Brad, what about this movie worked better for you this time around versus the last time?
Well, I think the opening of the film is a damn good opening.
I agree. I think it's probably the best.
Brody coming to in mid free fall as he's been kicked out of a spaceship that he's unaware of, and waking up on this planet, not realizing what the hell is going on, and other people in that same situation. I think the setup is really strong. I think what the movie is missing is that psychotic energy that Predator 2 has.
Yeah.
And the characters in this movie are all tropes. You know, there's the African warlord. There's the cartel guy. There's the racist prisoner. There's the serial killer. There's the Yakuza. There's the sniper. And it's just like, okay. But yeah, they did hire some strong actors to play those roles. So there is some fun in having Danny Trejo and Alice Braga and Walton Goggins,
yes,
and Topher Grace, I think, is really fun once that mm-hmm. character is revealed.
Mm.
But that middle part of this movie, you're like, you should be excited when suddenly you find Lawrence Fishburne has been on this planet for right. 10 seasons.
Yeah.
And he is playing the character so kooky and out of touch. It's such an awkward, uncomfortable performance from Lawrence Fishburne, and it kills the whole film.
It really does. It's just the momentum just stops dead in its tracks. And I get, like, you know, there was drama to be milked from the ensemble we already knew and had spent the movie with. And I get throwing another wrench into it by being like, oh, here's a guy who's lived on the planet. But, like, they spend so much time just sitting around with him, and he's weird and nothing's really happening. And it doesn't amount to anything at all. And I just remember watching that whole scene and just being like, okay, the goodwill I had for this movie is kind of
drying up.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, it finishes, strong's not the right word, but it finishes on a high note.
There's
I like
fun.
It.
There's
yeah,
fun.
Adrian Brody getting all mudded up like Schwarzenegger. That's fun. I like the Topher Grace turn. It feels like you could see it from a mile away, but it's still fun the way they do it. And, you know, it doesn't quite stick the landing, but it doesn't end completely, like, it doesn't fall flat on its face. It does manage to kind of stumble across the finish line. But I think that's what's disappointing about it is, to me, this should be the best sequel in theory, but it's just not. It's just kind of a missed opportunity.
Well, like the first film, as you were saying, Sean, you're watching like this 80s action film, and in the background, there's this science fiction thing. Mm. And then with Predators, like the moment they come over the hill, they see the horizon of this alien right. landscape. It's like, no, we're going to do Predator now as a science fiction movie. Let's get nuts. Mm-hmm. And it just yeah. never gets nuts. Like,
yeah,
it's so frustrating. And the movie is obsessed with callbacks to the original film. And I just don't understand yeah. why.
Yeah, like Adrian Brody covered in mud and shirtless, I'm here for it. But yeah, some of the other stuff is just kind of
like line
why
readings,
remind us?
The Russian with the Gatling gun. And if you thought Jesse Ventura's Gatling gun was impotent, well, guess what? This one's way more full of blanks.
Did you pick up, I'm not sure if it was supposed to be, but you know, the not the little dog creatures, but the
I like them.
The bipedal ones that kind of look mantis-y.
Yeah.
Were those taken from the original concepts of the original Predator design?
I would not be surprised.
It kind of looked like it was supposed to be.
Yeah, I feel yeah. like that's probably true, but I have not gotten that confirmed with my Predator experts.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. Anything else about Predators we need to say that we're just dying to say?
Well,
no.
Can we just talk a little bit about Adrian Brody's performance? Like,
sure. Yes,
he's coming off
Adrian,
the pianist,
basically,
right?
His paycheck.
What, Bat Brody?
It's a weird performance. It is very much Bat Brody. Yeah.
Yes.
Christian yeah. Bale, gnarl voice. It's odd.
Yeah, it for sure. I guess, you know, he'd, what, done King Kong a few years earlier, where he wasn't like an action hero in that, but that was kind of, I guess, his first attempt into like big special effects action movie. And I feel like he saw this as his big opportunity to say, yes, I can be the leading man in an action movie. But, and he's not bad, but yeah, it's weird.
I mean, it's weird. If anyone has the energy of Predator 2, it might be Adrian Brody in this, because he is reaching for something. I think it's a whiff, but I kind of like it. But it does ultimately kind of, it equals the moment in which his leading man career was over.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah, you're a character actor, my friend.
Yeah. Stick with that. All right. Aaron, anything else to add?
No.
Okay. So Predators, I guess final ratings, awesome asses. How many awesome asses would you give Predators, Brad?
I give it 3.5. I also like to team up with the Predator at the end. And I like the like race war between the Predators. I think that's kind of interesting. 3.5.
That is cool. Aaron?
I'm right down the middle. It's fine. It's a 3-star movie. I always liked Danny Trejo just popping up in a movie. It had some good action. Adrian Brody was there. That's all I can say. The middle did throw me off, but I'm going to give it 3.
I'll give it 3 as well. I think it's a fine movie. It's not the major improvement over Predator 2. I think it was trying to hail itself as. So now we're moving on to the Predator. And again, this is a situation where, in theory, all right, Shane Black, he had a bit role in the first movie, and now he's coming back to write and direct, fresh off of The Nice Guys, fresh off of Iron Man 3. He's got his chops. He's ready to take on a blockbuster. He's ready to return to the land of the Predator. Again, in theory, all of this sounds amazing. And I remember seeing like the announcements of his involvement, seeing the trailers and thinking like, oh yeah, this is going to be fun. First time watching it. Aaron, do you want to kick us off with some thoughts on The Predator?
Yeah, because I'm probably going to be the odd man out. I liked it just fine. Shane Black has had such a storied history with this. Now, you know, Brad, maybe you can chime in with his involvement. But from what I understand or what I remember is that he was originally brought on to do rewrites for The Predator. He didn't really want to or didn't. I can't remember what the story was.
He says he didn't do it.
They just said... He says he didn't do
it? Yeah, he was on set to be the guy to rewrite scenes.
They just said, come on down, we'll put you in the thing, and then while you're here, we'll have you do rewrites. And he said he never did. Is that correct?
That's his story. Do I believe that story? I don't know.
Yeah. But why would he lie about that?
I mean, I don't know what goes on in Shane Black's head. I trust no one, Aaron.
I understand that. I like this. This is big, dumb sci-fi. And this felt more akin to, Shane Black. If Shane Black had any sort of writing with the original one, this kind of felt like it had that same sort of, big machismo sort of feel to it, but on a very now sort of time. I feel like you guys are gonna be on
really
the attack on this one.
Position.
Yeah, no, it is only because I've seen Brad's scores. Okay, that's something.
You don't rate on Letterboxd.
I rate everything. I rate and review everything. I'm not afraid. I'll come out, but I
don't star it. And when I know you guys are spying on my Letterboxd, I know you're out there.
Always. But I feel like I'm gonna be defending this for a movie that I'm just fine with. But go. Go, Brad.
Go, Brad.
It's garbage.
I knew it. I knew it was coming. I don't know what to say because it's not that I completely disagree with you. I just don't think it's garbage.
I love Shane Black and I love Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. I love The Nice Guys.
But this isn't Shane Black. This doesn't feel Shane Black.
I mean,
agree. It doesn't.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay. Why am I even speaking, Aaron, if you're going to say all the smart things? This doesn't feel like a Shane Black movie. It feels like somebody trying to do a Shane Black movie. It feels like a Shane Black with his hands cuffed behind his back movie. I think that there are moments in it that have potential, but I would say like in Predators, when you watch Predators and the Predator back to back, boy, does it make Predators better. Okay. But in Predators, you have these like two-dimensional characters elevated by the actors who are inhabiting the characters.
Right.
Okay. In this movie, they're not as two-dimensional as they are in Predators. Many of the characters are injected with quirks and characteristics that I find baffling. Like Shane Black's trying to do something a little different with this busload of disenfranchised vets. And then the actors, they're trying to all bring that Danny Glover energy to their roles. And you're like, guys, only one, maybe two of you can go full Danny Glover. All right. The rest of you gotta slow down.
Yeah, I'm with Brad on this. This is not to spoil my ranking, but I think this is my least favorite of the franchise. I love Shane Black, and I would even say this feels like someone trying to do Shane Black. It there is no Shane Black in this movie, you know, aside from the quirky, weird characters.
I think there's some dialogue that feels blackier.
Some of the jokes, but I think the one-liners and the punchline, shockingly, I think the ratio for hits and misses is shockingly in favor of misses. Yeah. Like, there are some flat out clunkers.
Keegan-Michael Key's introduction in the bus is embarrassing.
It's painful.
I love him. But yeah, it doesn't work.
Well, that's the thing. And he, you know, when you said just full on Danny Glover, like the energy he's bringing to that performance is as if like Shane Black is on his A game, and he's not. And it just makes every actor falling on their face, like to deliver these lines, it makes it that much more painful. The concept of Predator works best when it's the Predator in an isolated scenario taking out people who are trying to survive. And in this, they're just like in the middle of a suburban neighborhood. They have access to everything they need. And that to me is just less exciting in general. But then when you add on top of that, this kind of like, there's a snarkiness to the movie that it doesn't earn. That's completely Shane Black, like the element, the Shane Black element that he brings to this, this almost cocksure, like, yeah, it's funny, right? Like when they're talking about how they decided to name the Predator, that vibe is kind of peppered throughout the movie. And I'm like, you didn't earn this. This is not deserving of that vibe. And again, a great ensemble cast just saddled with this kind of very underwhelming, like, why would you bring Tom Jane in the mix if you're just going to have him be like the cliche Tourette's syndrome guy?
I think he comes off pretty unscathed. Like, I think the Tourette's thing is not a good call, although apparently Shane Black suffers from Tourette's and that's why Thomas Jane is inflicted. But I think Thomas Jane, out of all of them, I could have continued to follow him a little longer.
He should have been the last man standing.
He was the guy who was doing the Danny Glover energy the best.
You want him to be?
You guys
Danny
are
Glover.
Backwards.
Yeah,
you guys watched this upside down, didn't you?
I mean, compared to Keegan-Michael Key, compared to Jacob Tremblay, I just think that especially Sterling K. Brown. Like, I love Sterling K. Brown. Hotel Artemis, he's so good in Hotel Artemis, but his like government agent, he's in charge of the Stargazer project, and I do think that's kind of an interesting thing where now the government is just waiting for the Predator to land so that they can score all his tech. I like that the government is ready for the Predator, of course not really, but Sterling K. Brown's performance, where he is like this vicious asshole, is one, not funny, two, not intimidating, and three, not convincing.
In a Predator movie, you're looking for convincing? You're like, that just makes no sense.
Yes.
Listen, this is
convincing.
There's
as
a lot
a
of
human
swings
being.
There. We're not we're against Predators. Okay, we can discuss that later.
Convincing,
but we're
compared to every other Predator movie we've talked about.
No, I agree. No, I completely agree with that. But I mean, every single Predator movie that we've had has been like a completely different flavor. It's been a completely different ice cream. It's been like a different dessert each time. So there's no connectivity.
I just don't like this poo flavored ice cream.
Like a what flavored?
Poo.
Poo flavored. Listen. There are you guys have talked about a lot of big swings going on with this movie. A lot of big, you know, people like turning up to, you know, full Danny Glover, full Bill Paxton, like just really going for it. And guess what? I feel like I would rather go for that as opposed. It feels like it makes me want to take my Predator score and drop that. Because there was a lot there where like it's just Adrian Brody like moping around with a gun.
Dude, you cannot tell me that the Predator is better than Predators.
I'm telling you with certainty.
Oh my God.
I'm telling you right now it is better than Predators.
Ugh.
telling you.
My heart, you can't hear it. It's just ripping in half.
I hope it does. I hope it rips right in half. And I hope it's the predator with that double spear stabbing, thing going right
what
through.
About
right,
the
right,
super
and then
predator?
And then,
what about Mr. Swoliosis? The
oh,
super
no,
predator?
That was... Listen, here I am. I'm having to defend something that I just sort of kind of like, that is just passable. That's what I hate about this
you
podcast
no
you bring
one
me
is,
on.
No
you
one
guys
is
hate this movie.
You.
You
no
guys hate
this
movie.
You, to do this.
You guys hate this movie that I just kind of sort of like. And I'm having to pretend like it's the best thing in the franchise. And I think it's like the most mediocre of the franchise. But that's what I'm having to do.
This is, I was going to say borderline offensive, but I think it is incredibly offensive in how it handles autism, how it handles post-traumatic stress syndrome, how it handles Tourette's. Like, I think it's really... really weird what it's doing with mental health in this movie.
I think it's kind of, it's baffling, and it's so, yes, it is offensive, but it's so hilarious that it's like, I'm like, why did you bring all these Oscar nominated amazing
Sean.
People into this movie to make like this? You cast Jacob Tremblay in this role that it's going to be like, oh, he's one of the smartest people in the movie. And he actually.
The next step of evolution.
Yes, the next step of human evolution. And it's just like, why do you cast this kid, give him nothing to do, and then on
no, they give him too much to
add,
do, dude.
Add,
they give him too much.
You add insult to injury by just making, yes, oh. The next step of human evolution. It's like. On every level, dude, I'm like, where were
I can't
what,
even I can't
why?
Even fight back. I can't do it because I don't fully disagree with you. I just don't have a problem with it.
When the predator is talking to them through the voice box machine, this is also the Predator movie in which we have predators having conversations and they are subtitled. Like, it's not good, dude. It's not good.
But I will say this.
They did that in AVP.
It was good then. It was good then.
Shut up. Shut up. Shut up.
I will say, I think my favorite part of the movie is the predator in the back of the van shoving through the guy's arm with the thumbs up. That was legitimately the only part I really liked. But the sheer gall of ending this movie with like a tease of like the predator killer and being like, you guys are ready, right? And me being like, absolutely not. I don't want any more of this. I don't care about the predator killer. Please make this stop. That hurts, and the fact that it's Shane Black really, really hurts.
Do you know the whole deal with the ending with the Predator Hunter armor?
No, what is it?
So originally they wanted to get Arnold Schwarzenegger to be in the film. And when I was watching the film the first time, I assumed that coffin was supposed to open and Dutch was going to step forth. But that's not true. That when they had Dutch attached in the script, Dutch was going to come in at the end in a cameo sequence. A helicopter was going to land and Dutch was going to step off and bring Boyd Holbrook's character with him. And then they would go off and have a predator hunting adventure. This is according to IMDb. But originally that coffin was supposed to open and Ellen Ripley was going to be in it. This is what IMDb says. And then they were like, no, it can't be Ellen Ripley. I'm sure they did some math on the time situation, how old Ellen Ripley would be in 2018. And then they said, no, we'll use this to set up Neil Blomkamp's version of Alien, which was going to be a sequel that ignored Alien 3, and it's Newt in the coffin. Again, doesn't quite make sense.
I wish I could have been
all of that, and then they just put in this predator robot situation.
Yeah, and the guy, but then the vanilla bland hero of the movie is like, "That's my new suit," or whatever he says. Where it's just like on every level, I'm like, "No,
dude,
no."
If he had worn that mech armor at like the 2/3 mark, I might be more on board. Like, if this movie went full wacky, if this movie went full Predator 2.
It should have.
I think I'd have a lot more fun with it. But it never does. Yeah.
It never does. Aaron, one last chance. Anything? What works? What works in the movie?
The line, you know who Whoopi Goldberg is? It's an alien Whoopi Goldberg. Is a perfect line.
Offensive.
To whom?
To Whoopi
exactly.
Goldberg.
The Predator.
No, I got nothing else for you other than Sterling K. Brown deserved an Oscar for this role, and that's all I'm going to say.
Oh, man. Well, I guess how many... we'll just wrap it up, and we'll jump to Prey. How many Sterling K. Brown Oscar-worthy performances... We didn't even talk about Olivia Munn because I forgot she was in this movie.
Jake Busey's in this flick, and he's pretty good. He's pretty good. And again, this movie cements Predator 2 in the timeline, even though that makes no sense, because clearly Predator 2 is set in an alternate universe.
Right. Okay. So let's just say, yeah, Sterling K. Brown's Oscar-worthy performance? I don't know.
Oscars he never got for The Predator. How many of those?
The Oscars he never got for The Predator. How many would you give it, Aaron?
I give this 3, and you guys are making me want to give it more, but I just can't. I just don't know. I don't know what I'm doing with my life anymore. I just don't.
I don't either. Brad?
2. I give it 2 of those.
Yeah, two for me as well.
Brings us
to two non Oscars for Sterling K. Brown. I'm sorry,
goodness.
He deserves a real Oscar someday.
He is great in this. He is great.
He watched Ocean's 11 and he was like, Brad Pitt. Yes. All of his acting comes from the way he eats nachos. I'm gonna do that.
more gum, please. Yes, I agree with you.
Actors need to stop finding character through eating food.
Yeah,
Food is great.
I want to eat food watching them act. That's all. The only person who should be eating food is me. Let's go ahead and jump into Prey, which is a movie I really, really wish could have somehow, like, kind of like the Blair Witch. We didn't know the sequel was the Blair Witch 2, even though that movie blew, apparently. I wish they'd been able to carry that all the way to its release without anyone knowing it was a Predator movie. I think it kind of, you know, obviously that had to leak at some point because you want people to watch the movie. Realistically, marketing, you can't not admit it's a Predator movie. But I kind of wish we'd gone in surprised, like, oh my God, it's a Predator movie.
That would have been epic.
That would have been epic. Not realistic, but all that said, I can't remember who started last time. I'm just still reeling over Aaron's liking The Predator more than Predator, so I'm gonna let Brad kick this one off. Brad, Prey, talk to us about Prey.
I like it. I wish I loved it. I really do, because I think there's a lot about it that is absolute quality, and the setting is obviously unique, and Amber Midthunder is amazing as Naru. But I think I feel the way that you did when watching Predator 2, and you're like, this feels a lot like the same beats of Predator. There was too much familiarity to the structure to prevent me from really engaging with what was going on in Prey. And I know I'm in the minority there, and I should probably watch this film outside of the context of the Predator franchise, and I might be able to enjoy it more. But my first watch of it, I was a little underwhelmed. And my second watch of it, I remained underwhelmed.
Aaron, how do you feel about Prey?
This is why you can't trust any of Brad's ratings or critiques on anything, because Prey is great. The only fault that this movie has is that it did not get a theatrical release. This should have been up on the big screen. This should have been larger than life. This is exactly what the Predator franchise sequels, God bless Predator 2, and it kind of is sort of in a way, you know, still related in that sense. But this is how it should have played out each time we got a Predator movie. Is just, you know, we have this creature that goes through time and starts taking out some of our greatest warriors, or creates warriors within these mythologies and these timelines. I sincerely love this movie. I thought it was fantastic. The action is great. Like Brad said, Amber Midthunder is fantastic. I wanted, and it's not even that I need more of this movie specifically. It literally just made me want to go and say, all right, this is our template for movies from here on out for the Predator. Stick this thing in feudal Japan with a samurai, stick him in Viking era, you know, put him against the mafia, you know, put him up against Black Friday shoppers, you know, just do anything where he's in an enclosed area, he's taking out people, and one person rises to the challenge to counteract this creature. And I thought this was fantastic.
I agree with everything Aaron just said. And I do think that if I had experienced the movie on the big screen, trapped in a theater, away from my phone, I probably would have engaged with the movie better than I do at home. Because as my
Brad, I'm going to buy you a lockbox for your phone.
You should.
That's what I'm going to buy you a lockbox. You should. So every time you put on your streaming device, you unlock it, you pop it in, you say buy phone, you lock it, and maybe like even like a timed issue or something.
I would appreciate that. And if you got that for my birthday, it's coming up, I'd be okay with it.
Yeah, I you know, this was not on my radar at all, and obviously once it came out, and once I realized, I was like, oh, it's a Predator movie. Oh, great. Like, and then the reaction to it was so overwhelming.
That was the positive. Other problem is everyone was so gaga. I think I got clouded by that.
That's and that's fair. I can understand that. People were really, weak, really gung ho.
I can tell that. I can tell.
Brad just doesn't like other people to enjoy things.
Brad just doesn't like other people,
before
period.
He can enjoy them first. That's really all this is about. But yeah, I was actually, the whole reason I wanted to do this Predator franchise rewatch is because I wanted to see Prey. And to get to Prey, I had to get through all these other Predator movies. But yeah, I'm with Aaron. I'm not quite as in love with it as Aaron is, but I thought this was great. I think it's my favorite Predator sequel for sure. And it does what I think Predator movies do best. It's when you take a character, put them on their own, give them like just the barest tools to survive with, and they have to use their wits and outsmart this crazy future enemy. I think Prey arguably does that better than any other movie in the franchise, but I think it's trying to hit some character beats in a way that it doesn't quite work, like the family stuff and the, like, you can't do anything because you're a girl. Like, it just was a little too on the nose. The emotional beats with her brother dying don't quite work for me, but everything else is great. I think Dan Trachtenberg is awesome. I love 10 Cloverfield Lane. It's really cool to see him bring that vision to this franchise. I think this is really like the only other thing he's done since 10 Cloverfield Lane, which is kind of shocking.
I mean, he did some television stuff.
Yeah, he did Black Mirror stuff, but like that, this is the only other movie he's done recently, is kind of nuts. But I think the movie looks amazing. I think it's probably the best looking Predator movie. It just, I love the way we're shooting on location, which none of these movies really had a problem with, but it's just something about like the environment being out in nature, with nature being part of the threat in a way that it hadn't been really before, like with her fighting off bears and us seeing the Predator kill like these animals out there and you get to see him hunting. I really enjoyed that, and I thought there was some really cool stuff in this that kind of elevated it. The main character's journey was nice. It doesn't quite hit all the beats, but I think it works pretty well. And there's a great oneer of her just taking out all those guys with her axe. That is kudos to everybody around. I don't know if it was a real one-er. I don't know if they faked it. I don't care. It looked great. And I had a blast watching it.
If I was the asshole that Aaron thinks that I am, my review, my very dismissive review of this film would be, Prey is a movie... No, how am I going to set this up? Prey is...
I'm waiting.
I'm praying you come up with something good.
Prey is a Predator movie if it wanted to be in the Criterion Collection.
Is that a wrong... Is that a bad thing?
Delusions,
I don't know if that's a bad thing. Yeah. I can see that, though. I can see what you're saying.
It's like the A24 branded Predator movie.
you're saying all the right things. I don't understand these criticisms. Listen,
it's no Predator 2 is what I'm saying.
Now we're talking Criterion, baby. I think the one thing that didn't work for Sean, the emotional beats, they worked for me.
Okay.
I think, and it's not one that I've yet watched with my daughter, but I think it's one that I would really like to watch with her, and one that I think that she would absolutely dig, just because it has that female empowerment, message. That sure, you can kind of think that it's hit on the head, but I mean, it's the stuff that happened. I mean, it is the absolute realism of the moment. And, you know, sometimes we have to say the stuff out loud for the people that aren't hearing it, you know, that's the unfortunate part. And this one just really completely hit. But the action beats were perfect. That Mortal Kombat level tomahawk on a rope, get me one of those for Christmas. I missed it. And I thought it was just fantastic. One thing that I thought was really cool, I haven't read if this was a callback or anything, but there's the one scene where right after she just gets trapped by the French trappers, and they release or they show her that they caught her brother as well, and then they cut her brother's chest, you know. In the same sort of motion that Sonny Landham cuts his chest.
It's a callback.
Not only was it a cool callback, because I mean, we've had plenty of other callbacks from other movies where in Predators, where they just say lines. You're like, why? You're like, yeah, shut up. It's like, what are you doing? Why are you even in this movie? But when you see that, and it has like a sort of resonation where it feels like it's a story that has been passed along for like, you know, from warrior to warrior of like, this is, you know, something that, you know, this ancient warrior did when they were, you know, up against this sort of foe. It just had that sort of feeling of passing down stories through word of mouth. And it just kind of, I really liked that. And the sort of connective tissue that it feels like what I want in a Predator movie, which is this thing, which is dropping a Predator into this scenario. And then, you know, just all hell breaking loose. That's what I want. But having that connective tissue, this one completely worked for me. It's hard for me to like really put it into words, but again, a great score that is unlike any of the other sort of militaristic tones of, you know, the Silvestri scores that we had before it, but this kind of beautiful, kind of whimsical, very powerful score that was going through, plus the Predator just looked great, had a very different look coming from, you know, awesome. Alec Gillis and Tom Woodruff just knocked it out of the park. Plus a good boy dog. Like,
yes,
what more could you want?
They win me over with the dog every time. I think it's fair to say, and I'm curious what you think, Brad, but this really is the only Predator movie that wants you to invest in the characters emotionally, really. Like, the Predator half-assed it, and really none of the others tried it. But this is the only one where it's like, oh, I care about this girl, and I don't want her to get killed. I don't want her brother to get killed. I actually am invested in her story, and I want her to survive. And I think the movie... You know, if it's the A24, the Criterion Collection Predator, I'm like, hey, go for it. Like, I want to see Trachtenberg's work here. To me, kind of reminds me of like Matt Reeves on Planet of the Apes. Like, he's bringing a level of visual understanding and sophistication to kind of a franchise fun movie that hasn't seen kind of quieter poetic moments as much. So I was all up for it. But I do think like, it strains a bit because the script isn't quite sophisticated enough to meet that filmmaking level, but I appreciate what it's trying to do and that it wants you to be emotionally invested in this story, because that's really not something we've seen in this franchise.
Yeah.
I think the script is simple, and that's exactly what it needs to be. I don't think you have to overthink, you know, something like this. I think creating good character arcs through not even just, giving something to say, but just an emotional take of, you know, relationship between brother and family and who you are, you know, where you reside in your group, your tribe, your whatever that you relate to. I think it was so understated in, but you're right. The character involvement that we haven't really gotten from really any of them. I mean, it's definitely something that's vastly different. It just has a predator like stuck right in the middle of it.
And dog. Let's not forget dog. But Brad, the problem is that we switch into emotional, meaningful connection, and you just want balls to the walls.
I want a B movie. You know, I want a B movie. And
B movie.
All the Predator movies up until Prey are B movies.
Right.
And I appreciate Dan Trachtenberg wanting to bring a little A sauce to the franchise. And I think he does succeed in that. It's just not the vibe that I'm feeling with the Predator franchise.
I gotcha. I really think there was a missed opportunity to call this movie Prey Deters.
No.
Anybody?
No.
Anyone?
Get out of here.
Let's
stop the recording right now. Do you have the stop button, Brad?
We're done. I think most of our listeners have.
That's the sequel title anyway, Sean.
That's what we're going to call it.
I was going to go for Eat, Pray, Love, but whatever.
Yeah, I like that. I think we'll go with that. I don't really have much else to say about Prey. I really thought it was a lot of fun. I think it is. And we're going to keep seeing this as the cinema, the future of cinema is uncertain. And we're going to see more of these amazing crowd pleasers just end up on streaming services when they really belong in a theater at a midnight release with a crowd that's like into it. This is one of those movies that I think suffers from not having gone to a movie theater. I don't know why. I don't know. I see the strategy. I understand that maybe.
Well, they couldn't allow it to go on to HBO Max. That's why it never went to the theaters, is because 20th Century Fox had a deal with HBO Max for their movies to go to streaming after they played in theaters. And when Disney acquired 20th Century Fox, Disney was like, well, we're not going to let anything go to their services. So let's just dump this on our service so we maintain all control over it.
That's the sad thing about the landscape right now, is that that even had to come into play. Like, see the movie in the theater, see the movie at home, whatever floats your boat. This would have been so much fun to see in a movie theater.
It would have been way more fun to watch on Disney Plus than Hulu, though.
Yeah, for sure. I can dig it. So, all right, are we all done with Prey? All right. How many adorable dogs from on a scale from 1 to 5 do you give Prey? Brad, we'll start with you. Let's just rip the Band-Aid off.
I give it 3. It's a good movie. It's good. It's not garbage. It's not the Predator. It's good.
Aaron, what about you?
It's a great movie. This is a 4-star movie. It is a solid 4-star. And it, honestly, if I didn't have a lot of emotional or nostalgic connection with the first one, I would probably say this one is my favorite Predator. Like, it is just, I think it's extremely well made. 4 stars, solid. If you don't agree, you're wrong.
Spoken like a true member of film Twitter.
It's the Last Jedi of Predator movies. How do you like that?
I love it.
I'm right in the middle. I'll give it 3.5, but I do agree with Aaron. I think this is perhaps objectively the best film in this franchise, but I just can't take it away from the first Predator because there's too much. There's too much about the first Predator that I love. So I think it's time for us to do our ranking. Thankfully, thank God, there are only 5 of these versus however many Star Trek movies there are.
7. But, there's 7. You ignored the 2 Alien v. Predator movies.
Oh, you're right. You're right. There are 7. I guess we will rank the
Can we talk Predator. Just super quick about how much I hate the naming convention of these movies? Like, it's not as bad as some other things, like the Jurassic World or
Rambo.
Fast and Furious's movie.
Rambo no, I can First give, Blood
I can give,
Part
I,
2.
I can get behind that. Okay. It at least gives me a part 2. I don't even get part 2s other than number 2. That's all we get. That's my soapbox.
Okay. All right. Well, who wants to kick us off with the rankings? Brad, do we want to start with you?
It goes number 1, Predator, the original. Number 2, Predator 2. Number 3, Predators. Number four, Whoa. Prey.
Whoa.
Number five, Whoa. The Predator.
And then where are the Alien vs. Predator?
Alien vs. Predator, number one, is right after Predators, before
Prey.
Oh,
I thought you said Predator. Predator number one.
No.
Predator,
oh, Alien AVP one, oh my, goes in between Predators and Prey. And,
that's insane. And then, that's insane.
Then the,
you put Prey in fourth place?
I do, and then the Predator. And then at the very end, we have Alien versus Predator Requiem. Even though the Pred-Alien is way better than the Super Predator in the Predator.
Yes, I can agree with that.
I'm losing my absolute mind.
Well,
over here.
Aaron, now's your chance to redeem this episode with your ranking. Go for it.
Number one is Predator. Number two is Prey. Number three is Predator 2. Number four is The Predator. Number five is Predators. And then AVP and then AVP Requiem.
Yeah, where do those fit in your ranking?
I just said it. Six and seven. That's where they fit.
Right before The Predator? Cool.
Nope.
What? Number one, Predator. Number two, Prey. Number three, Predator 2. Number four, mm-hmm, Predators. Number five, The Predator. And then I'm six and seven that. Are Alien vs. Predator and Alien vs. Predator Requiem, respectively.
I need to reach through the internet and shake your hand. Like, the only thing we have different, which I gave them 3 stars each, was Predators and The Predator. I've got no problem with that.
There you go. There we go. Brad, we were on the same
Brad
team.
Brad's an absolute maniac and doesn't deserve to come back, is what I'm saying.
A curve. Like, I wasn't ready for that.
Gosh.
I was ready for the Prey kind of, like, you know, let's have the more thoughtful, like, not going crazy about the film. But
Sean, I'm having
ranking.
Heart palpitations. This is literally the worst ranking he's ever done in my life.
I'm trying to think if I actually believe it or not.
the worst ranking in your life so far, because there are plenty more franchises out there for the Franchyze Boyz to
I just
on.
Really love the first Alien versus Predator. That's all.
That's so wild. I can't believe that.
Somebody has to love those movies.
I can't
believe
somebody has to be able to see them first. It feels like they're like they're filmed on black on black black. Can't tell what's going on.
You got to adjust your television every time you play.
My television is adjusted, friend. I saw that thing in the theater and on television.
You gotta watch
don't know what's going on.
You got to put the true motion on the way it was intended to be seen and get to it. Well, that's
Blackout
it for the Predator franchise. Yeah, that's it for the Predator franchise with the Franchyze Boyz. Aaron and Brad, thank you again so much for being on here. And if the good people at home want to find you out there on the interwebs, Aaron, where can they find you?
They can find me on social medias at A Cool Hand Fluke. I'm occasionally saying stuff on Twitter, somewhat posting things on Instagram, and always writing reviews for every single movie I watch on Letterboxd.
Brad, where can the good people at home find you?
You can find me on all social medias at MouthDork. Please check out the podcast I do with my wife, Lisa, Comic Book Couples Counseling. We just did our end of the year wrap-up talking about the best comics of 2022. We interviewed today Mark Wade about the new DC Comics event series Lazarus Planet. Had a ton of fun with him, so be on the lookout for that. And with my buddy Brian, I have started a public access television show for Prince George's County called The B&B Show. And you can find that on PGCTV's YouTube page. Please watch it on YouTube. We've got dozens of views. I'd like a few more. It's a very goofy, silly, wannabe Siskel and Ebert thing. It's very public
access. I was going to say, it is the, like, we need an at the movies for the 21st century. This is it. It's happening
it's
right
at
now.
It's at the movies meets Between Two Ferns. That's the energy we're going for.
I'm in 100%. And I am at Yay Shawn Dorman on Twitter. I'm Shawn Dorman 05 on Letterboxd. Thank you guys again. Always a pleasure to have the Franchyze Boyz together. And thank you everybody for listening. We will see you at the movies.